Let's pray. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. St. Bonaventure said that the Holy Spirit comes wherever he is loved, wherever he's expected, and wherever he's welcomed. So, come Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, we love you. Holy Spirit, we expect you. And Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Amen. Amen. Everybody stand up. You remember this? Yeah. There it is. Oh, the groans. Very good. There we go. Okay. There they are. All right. Turn to somebody next to you. Give them a high five and say, it is still good that you are here. And now everybody turn and wave at the people coming in right now and say, it is really good that you are here. Yeah. Very good. A little public shaming. That's so good. All right. Very good. Sit back down. Perfect. So the summer after my junior year of college, I was, I didn't know this yet, but I was going to be transferring to Franciscan University in Steubenville, Ohio. I was at the University of Michigan. But the summer after my junior year, my best friend and I, his name was Joe, we decided, we didn't know what we wanted to do, but we knew we needed to do something glorious. Okay, we needed to do something glorious. We kept calling it our glorious adventure. And it was just like rising up within the heart of a, 20-year-old man. I want to do something glorious. And so what we conceived of was we were going to go to Europe, and we were going to go to 7 countries in 10 days. 7 different countries in 10 days, culminating in Rome to see 2 of our best friends who were seminarians who were studying to be priests in Rome. Okay, fun fact, they have become priests. And it's wonderful to have friends who are priests because you get to go to confession all the time. I was so tempted to make up sins the first time I went to confession with my best buddy. I was like, I did this. No, I couldn't do that. That would be sacrilegious, horrible. But anyway, the point was we wanted to do something glorious, and it felt like going to Europe with as little planning as possible felt glorious, okay? So our plan basically consisted of we were going to fly into England and end up in Rome. We had a little bit of things that we had charted out that we were going to do. We had 2 enormous jars of peanut butter for lunch every day. We didn't eat breakfast because that was too expensive, and then we kind of splurged on like pasta in the evening. And really what it amounted to was these all sorts of different adventures across Europe, sleeping on trains, all of this. But my favorite one was we ended up in Germany, and the local people told us about this place called Burkischgarten, which is one of the great German words, isn't it? Burkischgarten. You almost have to say it angry to really make it come alive. But it is Hitler's, he built this as like his final fortress. So it's up in the Alps, it's beautiful, it's not the fortress, but the scenery, everything about it is just epic. And so we hiked up there, and one of the things we learned about Europe is Europeans don't put guardrails anywhere because they're like, if you fall off the mountain, that's your fault, right? In America, we put guardrails everywhere. In Europe, they're like, no, that's on you, man. So we loved it. We were climbing over rocks and doing all these things. And then out in the distance, we saw this alpine lake. And we thought, oh, epic, glorious. We should go jump in that, okay? And so we climbed down the mountain, asked somebody in town how far away the lake was. They said 15 kilometers. We thought, sure. We didn't know what that meant because we're American, and that didn't translate to miles or anything. So 15 kilometers felt reasonable to us, okay? So 15 kilometers is actually a real hike. And so by the time we got to the lake, we're checking our watches and realizing that our train, our overnight train from Austria, and kind of on the border there to Rome, we were going to be really close. But it was like glory, jumping in the lake, or the train. I mean, easy decision, right? So we jumped in that lake. It was epic. It was glorious. It was freezing. It was everything we ever wanted. And then the walk back 15 kilometers was still 15 kilometers and felt like it. And by the time we got to the train, we got on our first train. But wouldn't you know it, when we jumped off the next train to jump onto our connecting train, we missed it. And so we're standing in, I don't know, somewhere in the middle of Germany, facing a very long night of either sleeping in the train station in Germany or just basically hitchhiking on a different train trying to get to Rome. And so we're thinking about it, and again, the whole metric is what is most glorious? And it was like, sleeping in a train station, that's not glorious. Sleeping on a train that we're not supposed to be on, that feels pretty glorious, right? And so we just found a train, it said Roma on it, We're on. It was kind of like a movie, too. It's starting to pull out at the station. We like jumped on, and we made our way through the first couple cars, and we see the conductor making his way, checking tickets, which we don't have. So naturally, we hid in a bathroom. And if you've ever been in Europe, the bathrooms are small always, but the train bathrooms are very, very small. So you have to imagine two normal-sized men with their luggage squeezed in this bathroom with the door locked, like this close to each other, going like, shh, 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 don't say anything, right, as the conductor comes by checking for tickets. So I don't know how it worked. I don't know how we got away with it, but sure enough, they didn't check for our ticket. The guy walked past. We fell out of the bathroom together, which the Europeans, you know, not great, Bob, but we're doing okay, right? And so we're making our way through the train to try to find a place. We have about 8 hours on this train until we get to Rome, so we got to find a place to sit. And so we're checking every car, and the only car that we could find with any seats on it was, it's a six-seater car, and it's three seats on this side, three seats on this side, facing each other. And the only two seats available in the entire train that we could find were the middle seat on each side, okay? And so we peek in and go, well, not ideal, but better than standing the entire night. So we squeeze our way in there, and it got worse as I got in. So as I came in, the first woman on my left was, just think like quintessential European goth, like the scariest human being I have ever seen, okay? Like spiky hair, nose rings, and like spikes everywhere on their face and body. And I was like, oh my gosh, you know, like how are you not bleeding out with the number of holes in your face? And then I sit down, and there's this little babushka, cutest German grand lady. I mean, she is just the oldest, most wrinkled. I didn't even think she had eyes. You know, they're just covered in wrinkles. And she looks at me and just glares at me, which felt wonderful, you know? So I'm sitting there like this, kind of like, oh, okay, here I am. And then Joe comes in, and he sits directly across from me, and he ends up sitting between this, I think they were like Polish, a Polish couple, very much in love. I mean, very much in love, okay? They couldn't keep their hands off each other, and therefore, Joe was in the middle, right? I mean, it was awesome watching him suffer through, like, the petting and the gushing and the things, right? And so, man, we're just like, this is going to be a very long, very long car ride, you know? But glorious, glorious adventure, right? This is glorious. We just kept reminding ourselves this is glorious. So it's about 3 o'clock in the morning. I am as miserable physically as I've ever been. I am cramped because if I lean to my right, goth lady will stab me. It's a guarantee. If I lean to my left, babushka is going to babushka me. I don't know. She's gonna do something. And I'm watching my buddy Joe, who's basically now entwined with the Polish couple. And they're European, so, you know, it's happening. Not really, but, like, it's a thing. So it's about 3 o'clock in the morning, and all of a sudden, Joe kind of erupts out of his seat, does like a hit it onto the ground, face plant, and then rolls under the seat that he had been sitting on. And he's gone. And I'm like, son of a gun. And I kind of look down there, and sure enough, this is what I saw. Him curled up in the perfect fetal position, hands under, just smiling ever so slightly, sleeping. Not like a baby. You know, babies don't sleep well. It's a dumb expression. Babies poop in their pants and they wake up all night. Like, that's such a dumb expression. He is sleeping like an old person. I mean, actually, they wake up too. He is sleeping like he's drugged. I mean, he is out, just completely out, okay? And I'm like, man, how long has he been planning that, you know? And why didn't I think of that? And so now I'm starting to do the math. Like, do I fit? He's a slightly smaller guy than me. He's probably 5'10", maybe 150 pounds. So he's slighter and smaller. So I'm kind of like, can I fit? I think, and, you know, Spike Face over here and Graham over here, I'm just like, well, it's 3 o'clock in the morning. Let's go for it. So I kind of jump down, and I roll to get under the bench, just like Joe had done. And as I roll, this is true, I just get completely wedged underneath the seat. I mean, I am, like, totally stuck. And so the bottom half is under the seat, and the top half is just in the aisle for everyone to see, right? And it's so tight on my arm that I'm starting to lose feeling in my left arm. And I the more I move, I feel like the tighter it gets. I'm just like, oh. And I'm about 4 feet away from Joe's face now. And he's out, right? So I'm like, and so I'm like, Joe, hey, man, I need some help. And he's out. I'm like, Joe, I need you, man. Come on. And he's out. And so now I'm starting to panic a little bit because my arm's going numb. I'm like in serious pain. And again, bottom half under the seat, top half outside in the aisle. And so finally I'm like really like, and I'm kind of claustrophobic in anyway, so just I'm like, a panic is setting in. And I go, Joseph Patrick Falvey, wake up! And simultaneously, several things happened. Joe wakes up in a panic, sits up, hits his head on the seat, and gets knocked out. Yeah, bang, bang, boom. And now he's just, now he really is like drugged, okay? The couple gets so spooked, they just run out of the car. This is my favorite part. Spike Face stands up, hisses at me, and then leaves the car, which I just like, I pray for her every once in a while because that is just fantastic, right? And then this is God's honest truth. Babushka stands up, a stream of German comes out of her mouth, and she starts hitting me with her purse. Yeah, all simultaneously. But the good news is that the weight of Spike Face and Grandma standing up released the tension just ever so slightly. And I was able to roll under the bench to escape her blows. And I slept the rest of the way to Rome. Perfectly comfortable. It never even occurred to me to check on Joe. But when we arrived in Rome, we were both well rested. He had a big bump on his head. Glorious adventure, right? That was glorious, not only because it makes for a good story, but man, was it glorious to just kind of risk it all and so to speak to make it to Rome. And here's the thing. We know this, and one of the reasons a story like this resonates with us is because all of us, every single one of us, is made for glory. You've been made for glory. You were crafted by God, not just to survive, not just to kind of wander through life, but you were actually made for glory. This is part of the story I talked about on Thursday night. The culmination of the story that I laid out of the gospel is that God actually draws us into his life in heaven. And the glory that we long for, the adventure that we long for, is actually fulfilled as we come into union with him. We want glory because he is glorious. We want adventure because he created us that way. And so that desire within us, that feeling of like, I want more, I want to risk it, I want to go for it, is of God. It's worth celebrating. It's worth acknowledging. And it's worth fostering in our life, but where it kind of derails is the difference between what I want, when I like every glorious adventure, everything glorious, and actually I'll put it this way, everything worth doing in life. Yeah, I think I can say this, and you can correct me if I'm wrong. But everything worth doing in life requires risk. Requires risk. I'll never forget the first time my wife and I got to know each other. We were playing ping pong when I transferred to Franciscan, and she thought she was beating me, but I was playing left-handed. And then I switched, and the tables turned, literally, or figuratively, I don't know, college. Point was this, though, like I was starting to get pretty, I was like, man, this girl is something else. And I said, hey, can I get your number? I'd love to text you so we could hang out sometime. Good line. And you can use that, guys. And she said the most alarming thing back to me. She said, and this is going to date me a little bit, but she said, I don't have texting. It was like, wait, what? This was back when texting was very expensive, and her parents just said, no, we're not going to pay for texting. So guess what, friends? I had to actually call her. Yeah, I know. So here I am walking around the mean streets of Franciscan University with phone in hand, wrestling with the reality of, is this girl worth a phone call? Because my heart was like, oh, you know? And so I dialed that number with great trepidation, and I prayed that she would not answer and it would go to voicemail. And man, my heart stopped, and then it went to voicemail. And I asked her if we could go to Mass together, which apparently at Franciscan means basically you're married. And it probably means something similar here at Ave. And shockwaves went across campus because new guy and Kate Donovan are at Mass together, and I had no idea, and she was thrilled, right? And now we have five kids, so that's how the story goes. Yeah, you can clap for that. Five kids are great. The point is, everything great in life, everything worth doing in life involves risk. It requires risk. But here's the distinction. Risk for the sake of risk is foolish. And there are plenty of examples. You can probably ask any guy in here if you've done anything like silly or foolish just for the sake of being foolish or for the sake of risk, just for the fun of it. Now, a bunch of us have done it, okay? But risk for the sake of risk is foolish. But risk because of a calling, because of love, because of glory, that's called sanctity. I'm gonna say that again. Risk for the sake of risk is foolish. But risk born out of your identity and out of your calling that requires radical love, that requires perseverance, and that leads to glory, that's called sanctity. That's how we make saints. That's how the church cooperating with Jesus produces saints here on the earth. I'll give you a couple of examples. One of my favorite characters in the Bible right now is a guy named Gideon, okay? So if you want to read about Gideon, go to 1 Judges chapter 6. And Gideon is a good Israelite, and it's during one of those times where the Israelites, like so many times in their history, have just decided to ignore God. They've started to disobey him, and it actually says over and over again, they do what is wrong in the sight of God. And because of this, God gives them over to oppression, basically. And there's this tribe, the Midianites, that are laying waste to the Israelites. And what the Midianites are doing is basically they're saying, we're not going to conquer you. We're just going to steal from you. So the Israelites will, you know, harvest their grain. Excuse me, that was loud. They'll thresh their grain, and then the Midianites will wait, and then they'll come and they'll take it. And they'll say, thank you very much. And over again, the Israelites are starving because the Midianites are stealing all of their food. So where we find Gideon is he is threshing his grain inside his house. And I've never threshed grain before, but I've been told it's a very messy process. That when you thresh grain, there's a lot of stuff that floats into the air, a lot of dust and a lot of garbage and a lot of stuff that you'll inhale. You never want to thresh grain. Pro tip. You never want to thresh grain inside, okay? What that means is Gideon is scared. He's worried about the Midianites because he knows if he does it outside, they're going to see it and they're going to steal it. So as he's threshing this grain, all of a sudden an angel of the Lord appears to him. And listen to how the angel greets Gideon. He says, Gideon, you mighty man of valor. Which is a biblical way of saying, you courageous man. A mighty man of valor is a strong man of courage. That's how the angel greets Gideon. But he's not. He's afraid. He's scared. He's in some ways anything but a mighty man of valor. He's inside because of the Midianites, and he doesn't know what to do about it. He doesn't know what to do about his oppressor. And he doesn't remember who he is. Because Gideon has forgotten, just like the rest of the Israelites, they have forgotten who they are. And who are they? They're the chosen people. They're God's own people. They're the ones that God had brought out of Egypt. They're the ones chosen by God particularly with his blessing, with his protection, with his power. But they've forgotten it. And so Gideon, right before he's given a mission, a glorious adventure, God reminds him who he actually is. And who is he? He's a mighty man of valor. Why? Because he's one of God's chosen people. And that reminder, that renewal of his true identity, then produces in Gideon the strength and the vision to actually receive from the angel the mission that the Lord has for him. And what's the mission? To set the Israelites free. And what does it start with? And I don't have time to go through the whole story, but it's an awesome story. But what it starts with is Gideon, under the cover of darkness, tearing down the idols that the people had erected to false gods so that they could worship the one true God. Gideon, once he's reminded of his identity, immediately goes on mission, and it's risky. And actually, as the mission keeps going, the riskier and riskier and riskier it becomes. And the more he has to remember that I'm a mighty man of valor, that the Lord has chosen me, that he's called me, that he sent me, that he sustains me, that he gives me everything I need in order to accomplish my mission. And what does it culminate with? Gideon and 300 of his best guys, 300 men, destroy the Midianites. Gideon and 300 wipe them out. Not just biblically speaking, like truly, the Midianites are gone. Have you ever met a Midianite? Nope. Nobody has, because they're gone. Because Gideon and his 300 remembered who they are. They were launched and were willing to risk it all for the sake of the mission. They persevered into it, and glory came at the end. Let's take another a person in the Bible that you probably know a little better. Her name is Mary. You literally go to her university. Notre Dame claims that, but I mean, come on. How does Mary's kind of mission, glorious adventure begin? She's hanging out, not quite sure what she's doing, but she's somewhere. Gabriel appears to her. And what does Gabriel do right from the beginning? He reminds her who she really is. Hail Mary, full of grace. That's your identity, Mary. Gabriel knows, I'm about to give you the most glorious adventure. I'm about to give you the mission of all missions. I'm about to give you an assignment, an invitation that no other human being has ever been asked and no other human being will ever be asked to do. And so Gabriel knows that in order for Mary to be ready to receive that invitation, ready to respond full-heartedly, she needs to remember who she is. She needs to be reminded that she is full of grace. She has been set apart. She has been chosen. She is loved. She's been freed. She's been preserved. So Gabriel says, Hail Mary, full of grace. And then he gives her the mission, doesn't he? You are going to be the mother of the Most High. The power of the Most High is going to overshadow you. And the Savior of the world is going to be your child. And we know Mary, the amount of grit and risk and perseverance that we see in Mary every step along the way, don't we? Every step she had to keep saying yes to the mission that the Lord had put before her. Every step required more and more risk. Every step required a more and more understanding of, yes, I'm called to this, and if I'm called to this, the Lord then will sustain me in it. Because the Lord provides everything for whatever he commissions. Another way to put that is whatever he commissions, he provisions. Whatever he calls someone into something, he gives you everything you need in order to accomplish it. So for you, as he's calling you onto this campus, everything you need, brothers and sisters, to thrive, to be glorious, to be who you actually are created to be, everything you need is yours if you cooperate with it, if you're willing to risk it, to actually step into that identity. And listen, I'm no angel, okay? So I'm not an angel of the Lord, and I'm certainly not Gabriel. But let me remind you just for a second, as we close orientation, what your true identity is. You are beloved sons and daughters of God. The Father has chosen you. He has crafted you. He has brought you to this place because he loves you, and because he has a mission for you. That Jesus lives in your heart through the power of the Holy Spirit. That you are free, that you are strong, that you are loved, that you are anointed. I'm so sick of a generation. I'm so sick of a church that has forgotten that we're strong, that we're powerful, that the full power of God lives in us through the power of the Holy Spirit. Think about this, friends. Like, think about it for a second. What if you actually lived? What if we actually lived as if heaven lived in us? Like, what if we really believed and lived as if the Holy Spirit dwelt in our hearts? Think about how differently we'd live, how differently we'd think, the narrative we'd tell ourselves. But that's the truth, that you've been chosen, you've been set apart, you've been called, you've been sent, you've been equipped. And the question I have for you tonight, my question on Thursday was, who is Jesus to you and what are you going to do about it? My question I have for you tonight is, what are you willing to risk? What are you willing to risk? If we're playing poker, are you just going to bet a few, put some chips in? Or are you willing to go all in? Are you willing to stand up and say, yeah, I'm all in for Jesus? Are you willing to be known on campus as somebody who loves God? Are you willing to be known on campus as somebody who's virtuous? Are you willing to be known on campus as somebody who says no to that and yes to that? Are you willing to be known on campus as somebody who recognizes, and this sounds so silly to say this way, like nobody's going to walk around and be like, oh, I'm made for glory. But are you willing to be known as somebody who recognizes that, yes, I'm called to something greater even as I live right now? I'm living in the moment, in the mess, in the sweat of Ave Maria University, knowing, though, that I'm called to something greater. And I'm going to keep pressing towards that, and I'm going to stay sustained by Jesus in the pursuit of that. And the question is, what are you willing to risk? What are you willing to risk? At my freshman orientation, I was at the University of Michigan. I guarantee you, a very different orientation than what you've had over the last few days. The first session we had, one of the deans of students, this is so funny. So here, you got to imagine, I'm coming from like a little Catholic school. There's like 400 kids in the school, and so we're a very sheltered little existence. And I'm sitting in this room full of about 4,000 freshmen, okay? And the dean of students comes up, and he goes, welcome, everyone. And I don't know if he talked like that, but we're going to say that he did. And he starts on this, like, do's and don'ts on campus. And he's like, he literally goes, don't get drunk. But when you do, be smart about it. And I was like, what? And then he's like, don't sleep around. But when you do, be smart about it. And then this was my favorite one. He was like, don't do drugs. It's like, what is this, like a bad teen movie? He's like, but when you do. And he listed like 15 other things that we were not supposed to do that he was like, but go ahead and do. But and his like culminating idea was just like, be smart about it, which I'm sure you're far more advanced as a freshman than I was in my classmates, but like, be smart about it is literally the dumbest advice for a freshman in college. I mean, y'all don't know anything of what that means, okay? Case in point, my roommate at freshman orientation got really, really drunk for the first night, and I woke up, this is a true story, I was on the top bunk of our little room, and I was excited. I'm like, here we are, I'm at Michigan. And I jumped out of the top bunk, and I landed, and this is not a joke, 500 mouse traps immediately exploded around me because he had gotten so messed up that he thought it would be hilarious to set all these mouse traps for me. And it was like, it was horrible, yeah. Don't worry, though, I got him back. I set all them up in his bed. So the point is, we left this session of like, don't do this, but when you do, do this. And so I'm reeling. I'm kind of like, oh, my gosh. And here I am really, like, desiring to be a disciple. I love Jesus. Remember I told you the story when I was a freshman in high school and I didn't stand up to – I was ready to stand up for him. By the time I left high school, I was all in on Jesus Christ. He was the Lord of my life. What was I willing to risk? I was willing to risk anything at that point. And so we left the group of about 4,000. We ended up in a smaller classroom led by a senior. They call them, like, GSIs. I guess he was a graduate student. And he had that, like, air of, like, I'm going to show you guys what life is really all about. And so he's like, giving us the rundown of what campus is really like. And there's about 70 of us in this classroom. And I'm sitting there just like, man, this guy is kind of a, yeah. And all of a sudden he, I don't know why, but it was like a soapbox moment for him. And he started to go and he goes, and you know what? There's going to be these times where Christians are going to show up on campus. And they're going to stand on the in the quad, in the diag is what we call it. And they're going to preach at you. And he said, and even worse, there's going to be times when these pro-life groups show up. And they're going to have all these pictures of babies and all these things. And he said, don't even bother talking to them. My recommendation, this is true what he said. He goes, my recommendation is you just spit on them as you walk past. And so I'm like, oh, man, shots fired, you know? What's this about? And so in moments like this, what I always do, I say, Jesus, what do you want to do? Jesus, what do you want to do? Because sometimes he says, say something, and then other times he lets me off the hook. And I felt like Jesus said, you need to defend me. And I said, nah, like, try that again. Like, better option. There's got to be something. Like, you want me to write, like, a really sternly worded letter, you know, afterwards complaining about it? And Jesus said, no, you need to defend me. And I said, And then Jesus played the trump card. He said, Pete, you said you'd stand up for me. You need to defend me. And I said, Jesus, if you want me to defend you, you got to give me a power I don't have right now. And all of a sudden, I was on my feet, which surprised me and everyone else in the room. Because everyone else was sitting, and all of a sudden I'm standing, and the GSI is like, yeah, you all right? You want to say something? And I honestly don't remember what I said, but I know I spoke for about 5 minutes just defending Jesus. And it just kind of flowed out of me. I kind of like blacked out, you know? Like, and at the end of it, it was like, oh, man, you know? And at the end, I remember kind of like, finishing up what my thought, and I looked at him, and his eyes were about this big, right? And the entire room was dead silent. Not a single peep, not a like a yeah, man, or a nothing. It was just like, shh. And the GSI staring at me, and I'm staring at him, and he goes, you know, this was a good session, everybody. Let's come back in a half hour, and we'll talk about it later. And so I'm like, all right, well, I guess I did what the Lord asked me to do, and I'm okay with that, you know? So I start walking out of the classroom, and I get this tap on my shoulder, and I turn around, and there's this little freshman girl in front of me with tears streaming down her face. And she said, thank you. And I said, for what? And she said, I had been sitting there praying that somebody would say something, and I didn't have the courage to say it. And I have to tell you, what rose up in my heart was like, I could have really used you, you know? Like, it was pretty isolating. Where were you? But I didn't say that. I just said, oh, thank you. And I gave her a hug, and we went our ways, and I never saw her again. And I have no idea what the effect of it was on the GSI. I have no idea what the fruit of that was. But I was willing to risk it, to stand, to be accountable, to be who I really was. About 3 weeks after that, I'm in my first ever class at Michigan. It's a biology 101. And there's 550 students in a lecture hall, bigger than this. And I'm sitting in the back, and guess what? I'm pumped because I'm wearing sweatpants at school. Because after uniforms my entire life, the fact that I could wear sweatpants at school was like the biggest deal, okay? And then they were Michigan basketball sweatpants. They had been given to me. It was just like the greatest thing. So I was just happy to be there, okay? And the professor gets up there, and he starts going through the syllabus, and he's going through all the different things, and at the end of it, he comes to one of the sections, and it's something like evolution or something, and he goes, oh, just so you know, every single year when we get to this lesson, the Christians in the class come forward, and they always try to debate me, and they always try to convert me, and he goes, it's not gonna happen, don't even bother. And I thought, challenge accepted. And so first class ends, and there's a line of students to talk to him, and I get in line. I'm the last one in line, and I come forward, and I introduce myself. I say, hello, Professor. I'm Pete Burak. And I said, Professor, I just want you to know that I'm that Christian student. You know, I'm that guy. And it was interesting. I had a smile on my face. He did not smile. He immediately put his finger about this far from my nose and says, how could you possibly believe that? How could you possibly believe what you believe? Where's your proof? You've got nothing. You've got nothing. How could you believe that? And so I did what I would recommend in moments like that. I call it the lean back, smile, and ask. You lean back, you smile, and you ask a question. And I said, Professor, are you married? And he said, yes. And I said, do you love your wife? And he was like, yes. I was like, does she love you? And he was like, yes. And I was like, how do you know? What's your proof? And he's like, well, he does this. She does this for me. I was like, I know, but that's just behavior. How do you know? How do you know? How do you actually know? How do you measure love, Professor? And I said, because how your lack of an answer is the same way I know Jesus. I know he's real because I've met him, and I live with him, and I have an experience of him. And he's real because I know him. And he looked at me, and he goes, all right, kid, touche. Get out of here. And so I left, and I got a C+ in the class. Which had nothing to do with that moment at all. It had everything to do with my study habits, okay? There was no persecution there. That was just simply Pete not knowing how to do college, okay? The point is this. You can't predict the times or the seasons or the opportunities you're going to have to be and to risk it all. It's you're not going to be able to know when the Lord's going to be able to call you into, remind you of your identity, and call you into a mission that is glorious, that needs to be accomplished for his kingdom. You can't anticipate that. But what you can do is you can live in your identity such that when those moments arise, you don't have to debate it. You don't have to think about it. You can live from who you actually are. So I haven't given you any tips or any practicals in the two talks I've had so far. And some of you type A personalities are really freaking out about it. So I'm going to give you four tips, four things you can do to actually live in and through your identity ready for your glorious mission. Okay? You ready? You ready? Okay, getting a little better. Actually, everybody stand up again. Come on, we're not going to do this. All right, maybe one more. Yeah. Oh, yeah. There we go. Swamp Fest is coming. I don't know what that means, but it sounds swampy. I've been swampy all week. All right, sit down. Here we go. Some of these tips, you're going to be like, wow, I could have thought of that. Why did we bring him here for that? And, you know what? You probably could have, but sometimes we have to get back to the basics. I'll never forget my first practice with Coach Beilein at Michigan. He had transferred in. He had just been hired. He was known as this offensive guru. We couldn't wait to learn his new offense. And for the first practice of the Coach Beilein era at Michigan, any idea what we worked on for over 2 hours as a basketball team, Division I basketball? Free throws? No, far too advanced. Dribbling? Nope. No. Playing catch. This is true. We played catch for 2 hours. Why? Because Coach Beilein had learned that most of the travels in the game of basketball happen right after you catch the ball. So he taught us the fundamental of how to properly catch a basketball. And in case you're wondering, it's on the hop. That way, either foot's a pivot foot. There's your basketball lesson. But the point was, for 2 hours, Division I basketball players had to catch, pass. Fundamentals, friends. That was a long way of saying, be impressed by these fundamentals. Okay, so the first one. This first one in particular is really going to blow your mind. You want to live in your identity. You want to know your identity. You want to be prepared and sustained in your glorious mission. First one, first non-negotiable, I would say, is this one. Prayer. I know. Prayer. But let me give you a little bit of a nuance on it. I want to challenge you, freshmen, just to see what happens if every single day, let's just say for 10 minutes, you spend time alone in silence. And it could be walking across the quad instead of putting your earbuds in or whatever, instead of playing music or, you know, driving somewhere or just somewhere in the chapel, 10 minutes every day in total silence, letting the real God encounter the real you. And the prayer I would recommend to start that time is, Lord, let the real me encounter the real you. 10 minutes. My recommendation, the way I do this, because I'm terrible at silence, I don't like it, it's uncomfortable, I'm an extrovert, I like people too much. The way I do this is I set a timer on my phone, and generally I either throw it across the room or I, you know, if I'm driving, I put it in the seat next to me. And here's what happens. 10 minutes, right? The first 3 minutes are just a bombarding thoughts. There's anything but silence. It is just like chaos in my brain. The next 3 minutes, I'm wondering if I'm silent. You know, like, is this silence? I think this might be silence. I think I'm silent. This is good, right? Silence, God, right? Right? And then there's usually about 2 minutes in there of actual stillness before God. And then the last 2 minutes are me wondering when the alarm's going to go off. Like, gosh, this has been the longest 10 minutes of my life. Is it going to go off yet? Come on, it's got to be soon. And I tell you what, that 10 minutes has been some of the most fruitful time. Just 10 minutes of solitude and silence, alone with God, letting him speak, letting him move, letting him inspire. And I have to tell you, the most effective part of that 10 minutes is usually the last 30 seconds. If you're an athlete, you know what's the most important rep when you're doing the bench press or any other exercise. The most important rep is always the last rep. If you're set out to do 10, finish it. If you're going to do 10 minutes of silence, do 10 minutes of silence. Finish the time. I can't tell you how many times the Lord has spoken to me in the last 10 to 30 seconds of prayer. It's a challenge. I know Chris, last night, Stefanik had all sorts of challenges for you. He's really good at that. He's the challenge guy. So I'm going to sneak in there a little bit. Like, he talked about Snapchat. Good for him. We're going to talk about solitude and silence. So let's go another step forward. 10 minutes alone with God. Tip number one. Tip number two. If you want to know who you really are, if you want to know what you're made for, if you want to be sustained in it, you have to be reading Scripture. You have to be in the Word of God. Every single day, open up this book. Don't start with Leviticus because nobody will get through it. So start in John or the Psalms or somewhere in the New Testament and just read it. And friends, remember that this book is a love letter from God to you. It's a roadmap of relationship. It's actually understandable. You can get something from this. This is not just a dry, sterile book of sayings. There's life to this, but you have to actually open it. You actually have to read it. I can't tell you how many people I talk to who I'm like, hey, do you read Scripture? And they're like, yeah, I read Scripture. I'm like, oh, tell me about that. And they're like, well, you know, it's next to my bed. I'm like, okay. There's no Scripture by osmosis. It doesn't just like waft into your brain, right? You have to actually open it. And here's the Bible test I'll give you. If you want to know whether or not you're reading Scripture enough, you should be able to, with all of your Bibles, open to any page in the Scripture, and it should stay open. And if it doesn't, if it automatically closes, it means you're not reading your Bible enough. And if you don't know what I mean by that, it means you haven't opened your Bible in a long time either, okay? Every page should be able to stay open because it's worn, it's used, it's been actually, like, utilized, okay? So tip number one, pray, solitude and silence every day. Tip number two, read Scripture every day. Tip number three, and you've already made a great step towards this one, but if you want to live in your identity and you want to be sustained in your mission, you need people to run with you. You need a community. You need a tribe. You need to have a sense of people who know what's going on in your life and you know what's going on in their life. It's not enough to do this alone. And I would bet a lot of money that if you're alone at Ave, it's because you're not looking for life. You're not looking for friends. That every university I've ever been to darn near has a club for everything. You know, at Michigan there was a club for people who love squirrels. This is true. There was a squirrel club. And I know this because the squirrels at Michigan really started to annoy me because they weren't afraid of me. So we'd be walking through campus and the squirrels would come right up to you because they're so used to humans. And this is not one of my better moments, but this is true. A squirrel came towards me and I intended to just kind of like flick it away. But as I went like this, it jumped. And I caught it in that perfect, the momentum carried with it, and what should have been just like a 3-foot fling turned into about a 12-foot launch. As the president of the squirrel club was walking past. Talk about an earful, you know? I can't repeat any of what she said to me on that day, and I was so sad. I was like, I'm so sorry. I love squirrels too. What do I need to do? Do you need me to donate nuts? Like, what do you need me to do? I'm all in. Please don't cancel. Daily prayer, Scripture, community. And finally, the secret weapon of knowing your identity and living in a glorious adventure with the Lord, and honestly, it's impossible without this, is you need to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. There is no true identity in Christ. There is no true launch on mission without the Holy Spirit. I mean, think about this. The apostles had the best men's group ever, right? Many of us have been in men's groups. Many of us have been in Bible studies. They had the best one. All of our men's groups are led by Jesus. Their men's group was led by Jesus, okay? And they, you know, they saw all sorts of cool things. He fed them a lot. He raised people from the dead. He died, which was pretty dramatic. But then he was back, right? And he's walking through walls, and he's feeding them again, and they have to be thinking like, oh, man, let's go, you know? I don't know if they did that back in the day, but look, let's go. And then he brings them to that high place, and he kind of drops a bomb on them. He's like, all right, I'm out of here, peace. You know, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go make disciples of all nations. And they have to have been like, wait, what? You want us to build a kingdom? Like, you want us to go on mission? You want Peter? You know, Peter's my favorite character in the Bible other than Jesus and Mary for obvious reasons. But I love Peter because he's just so us. He's just so human. You know, one minute he's like, you are Christ, the Son of the living God. And then literally like four verses later, Jesus says to him, get behind me, Satan. That's a dip. Peter walks on water, sinks, walks on water again. Peter's the one who sees the transfiguration and has the most male response in the Bible. He's like, let's build tents, you know? Peter's the one at the Last Supper is like, you're never going to wash my feet. And Jesus is like, I got to wash your feet. So he's like, well, then wash everything, you know? He denies him three times. He says he loves him three times. He's just like you, man. He's up and down and all around. Actually, you're probably very steady. But he's all over the place. He's all over the place. The only consistent thing about Peter in the New Testament, in the Gospels, I should say, the only consistent thing about Peter in the Gospels is that he's inconsistent. There's just nothing. One minute it's like this. It's this total roller coaster. And Jesus knows this. And so he says, you're going to build the kingdom, but not yet. Not yet. Wait. Wait. Wait until you receive power from on high, and then you'll be my witnesses. So like good disciples, they do what they're told. They wait and they pray. And they're waiting in the upper room on that Pentecost morning, having no idea what's coming. They know the Holy Spirit's coming, but they don't know what it's going to look like. It's not like Jesus was like, there's going to be a big wind, but don't freak out. It's okay. Then you're going to speak in different languages. Don't freak out. Part of my plan. And then tongues of fire. I know, strange, but hang in there. Like, he doesn't say any of that. He just says, wait and pray. And they do, and they're open. And all of a sudden, Peter is filled with the power of the Holy Spirit along with Mary and all the other people in that upper room, and they're launched out of the upper room, and quite literally, the world has never been the same, right? All of a sudden, their identity, boom, as the rock. Peter's identity as the rock. Oh, he's all in now. What is he willing to risk? Everything. Why? Because he's filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. He knows exactly who he is in Christ. He knows exactly what he's supposed to do, and he knows exactly how he's supposed to do it. And he steps out of the upper room, and all of a sudden we see a totally different Peter. He didn't spend a week preparing his first homily. He just is launched out of the upper room, and all of a sudden he starts quoting scripture. Like, where'd that come from? He's like, we're not drunk. This was foretold. And he's like, boom, 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 boom. And it's like Peter, who was a squirrel, in the Gospels becomes this ringing bell of truth. It's just like bang, bang, bang. And it culminates with the message of the church. Let the whole house of Israel know assuredly. Let the whole town, let the whole university know assuredly that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. Jesus Christ is the Lord and he's the King. And this is what the Holy Spirit builds in us, confirms in us, and empowers us to proclaim. So, four tips. Pray, pray, pray. Read scripture. Have a community. Find a community. Invest in a community. And then ask for more of the Holy Spirit. And remember, when you ask for more of the Holy Spirit, it's not so much something that's out there that needs to come in here. It's more of you've, through your baptism and confirmation, been given the full power of God. It's giving permission to the Holy Spirit to work in your life. To not putting any constraints, or as Pope Francis called it, he said, do not cage the Holy Spirit. He says, do not cage the Holy Spirit. He said, be free. That's what it looks like to be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. All right, and finally, with the couple minutes I have left, pray, scripture, community, Holy Spirit. I just want to level with you guys that to live in this identity and to say yes and to risk it all for the sake of a glorious mission is, it's hard. hard, but it's worth it. Listen to this scripture from a book I'm sure you've read many times. Sirach, chapter 2. One time I was giving this talk and I said, a book you've read many times, Sirach, and then I heard somebody whisper, "Is that in the Bible?" I was like, "Yes, it is, right here, you know, kind of right in the middle." Okay. Sirach chapter 2. "My son or daughter, if you come forward to serve the Lord, prepare yourself for a trial. Set your heart right and be steadfast, and do not be hasty in time of calamity. Cleave to him and do not depart, that you may be honored at the end of your life." Here's the key part. Listen up, freshmen. "Accept whatever is brought upon you, and in changes that humble you, be patient. For gold is tested in the fire, and acceptable men and women in the furnace of humiliation." Furnace of humiliation. Sign me up. Doesn't that sound great? Who doesn't want that? Yeah, furnace of humiliation. Blah. Yeah, no thank you. That sounds horrible. Who invited this guy? Kim did, if you're wondering. Furnace of humiliation. What's the Lord saying there? "Accept whatever is brought upon you, and in changes that humble you, be patient." I have a, I would venture to guess that this year is going to be full of changes that humble you. So be patient. Why? "For gold is tested in the fire, and acceptable men and women in the furnace of humiliation." What is Scripture revealing to us right here? The furnace of humiliation is not something that God needs to create because he's mean in order to place us in it. It's not like, this will be fun. Try this furnace out. Bloop, you know, see what happens. No, we do that very well on our own. The world does that plenty. The fallen world that we live in, because we're not made to be here forever, we're made for glory, we're made for heaven, and we're in a fallen existence with sin, with suffering, with humiliation. We live in this world right now. There are plenty. You don't have to go looking for it. I guarantee you, your life will be full of furnaces of humiliation, some of which you create, some of which others create for you. And the question is, when you find yourself in a furnace of humiliation, when you find yourself with the fires raging around you and it hurts and you feel it, do you remember who you are or do you flee from it? Because here's what Scripture's telling us, that when you find yourself in a furnace of humiliation, what God is doing and what he can do is he's making you gold. You put garbage in a fire to destroy it. You put gold in a fire to make it more goldy. No, to make it more pure. Thanks. To make it more what it really is. What a furnace of humiliation can do when we unite it to God, when we remember that I am gold, is all of a sudden we emerge out of that fire, we emerge out of that furnace, we emerge out of those changes that humble us, more who we actually are called to be. And I promise you that if you live in your identity, that you say yes to the glorious adventure that the Lord is calling you into, you will navigate through fires that hurt, that make you suffer, that purify you, that detach you, that maybe even bring you to your knees. And the question is, friends, in those moments, do you remember who you really are and submit to it and say, "Yes, Lord, I am gold and I'm clinging to you"? Or do you try to do it on your own? Do you try to put the fire out? Do you try to push it all away? A couple years ago, my dad called me up, which was not unusual. My dad was my best friend. We had meals together every week. He was my hero. I love the man. We talked on the phone basically every day. And he called me up and he said, "Pete, I'm very sorry to tell you this, but I just got diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. Very rare form of cancer. Only 50 people in the country get it every year. The doctors don't know what it is, so they just keep adding adjectives to it. There's 8 words in its description. We started calling it WAC in our family, W-A-C. It stood for weird ass cancer. Dad's got WAC. I think I'm the first person who's ever said that on a stage at Ave Maria. President Middendorf, good to see you. Dad's got WAC. And what I watched was a 63-year-old man didn't smoke, didn't drink, worked out every day, small business owner, disciple of Jesus Christ, who was all in, who knew who he was. But man, I watched the man go through a furnace of humiliation. If you've ever had the privilege of walking with somebody when they die, in those final weeks and months, it is really hard. And it is really painful. And it is really humiliating. And at the moment that he was actually dying, he was covered in these like grotesque purple sores because that's how the cancer manifested itself. He had lost all of his weight, and he had these lesions in his mouth that caused him incredible pain, and he couldn't speak. And the moment he was dying, I was on his bedside holding his hand. My mom was on the other side, my brother and our wives and some family friends, and we were like cheering him into heaven. We were praying. We were just like, go be with Jesus, Dad. You know, we were trying to love him till the end. And here's my hero. This is my best friend, you know. And at the moment he died, what rose up within me, even as I was weeping, I was heartbroken, I was so sad, what rose up within me was joy. Because I was so happy for him. Because he was home. He had fought the good fight. He had finished the race. The prize of everlasting glory was his. I don't have the power to canonize, but goodness gracious, if he's not in, we're in trouble. And I had watched this man go through a furnace after furnace of humiliation. Changes that humbled him, he was patient. He cleaved to the Lord and did not depart. And I wish you could have seen his funeral. He was honored at the end of his days. Over 600 people filling our parish church, worshiping God in gratitude for this man. This is not a joke, friends. People have come back to the Catholic faith because of what they saw at his funeral. Because even though his outer person had totally wasted away, the inner man had come alive. He had become gold. And I know it seems a little crazy to be talking to a group of freshmen about death again. And to be highlighting the end of somebody's life right as yours is really taken off. But what I saw in my dad was the final glorious adventure of going all in and remembering who he was and saying yes to the Lord, that he crossed over that divide from life to death to life again. And that's what it's all about. And that's what we're building towards. And that's really the true glorious adventure. So friends, as you flow out of here into Swamp Fest and you start your year, pray every day in solitude and silence. Read scripture every day and remember what the Lord says about you. Find a group of people who you want to run with. Be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. Why? So that you might know who you really are. And as you know who you really are, you might say yes to the glorious adventure that the Lord has for you. Sound good? All right. God bless you.